Okay, what is the plan here? I was doing some live streaming and went to go get some spaghetti or something. Something Italian, but all the places are closed. So I ended up getting Mexican food. I was told I should watch this, so here I am going to watch this. This is a 4D game, Traveler, Wild Hell. I forgot these guys were doing a game. I thought today was Sunday all day for some reason. It says, what are you doing on Monday night? What do you mean Monday night? It's Sunday. No, there's. You should probably watch the game. So I'm like, okay, I'll watch the game, but I'm late to the party, pal.
Boat to his left. And I am your referee for the evening, Phil the Thrill. And thank you for joining us today. Some of you are awake as the armed guards are strapping you into your metal traveling pod. The belts are tightly fastened on you.
Okay, this is interesting. So you, when do you say you in the game? When does the referee say what you're doing in a game? Because player agency, right? The players want to say what they're doing in the game. But when the referee gets to say things like the guards are strapping you into the electric chair, they're not, the referee's not exactly role playing your character. They're just describing what's happening to your character. They don't say what your character's doing. They say what's happening to your character. Were we talking about this last night? Something about the referee gets to say things like, your character is losing their mind. Now, is that role playing the player character? You can't tell me what I'm doing. I'm not. The referee's telling you what your mind is doing. Like if a referee says, so and so walks up to you and cuts your arm off. The referee's not role playing that player character. The referee's just narrating what happened to that player character. So they're saying you guys find yourself on a desert island. You guys have reached your destination. You guys all got, all of you that got your arms vaccinated. Well, by the time the freighter boat drops you off at the island of Lost Souls, those of you that got vaccinated, your arms are already rotting and falling off. Leprosy. Leprosy has kicked in. You guys all have leprosy. Not really saying, the referee's not really saying what the player characters are doing. Just describing what's happening to the player characters. I'm all for it. If they're saying you in that instance, I'm all for it. You guys awake. That's it. But if I start saying something like, you guys get up, you get dressed, you go to the commissary, you go talk to the hair and makeup girl because you want to look fabulous for the next scene in the film. That would be me telling the. I'm basically role playing the characters at that point. So that's a no-no. talking in second person to the players. That's kind of a no-no. Anyway, let's hear some more.
And some of you are slowly waking up as your nature has required.
Yeah, when I ran a game, yeah, I never got to finish my story about. Yeah, last night I was saying, when I ran a game for my computer, and Mr. Max says, she's still mad at you. I totally forgot what I was even talking about. But yeah, what I wanted to say was when I ran the solo game, well, not really solo game. It was more like just one player. It was just a one player game. So I ran a Traveler game for my computer a long time ago. This is like 8-9 years ago. When I was still learning how to do the role play thing. And I remember in that video, I was saying you. Like the computer was trying to wake up from the hypersleep. And I was making the computer do rolls to see if they were totally awake yet. And if they weren't able to make a fist yet, I would narrate that they're trying to move their arms, but they can't. Or they're trying to let out a scream, but they can't. But at least their eyes are open. Because they're waking up from hypersleep. And I knew I wanted the computer to have agency. So the things she would say she's doing, I would let her do. Once she's awake and crap. I wasn't going to say, I don't think I said where she goes. I let her decide where she goes. Anyway.
That you be sedated until you are securely fastened in your seats. The men in full environmental suits, having being satisfied that they have strapped you in securely, make their way out of the pod as it begins to seal. The pod is has a very metallic construction, looks very modern day. Navy in its construction, so there's a lot of metal rafters and sort of a high ceiling. Looks like there are six people seated in a circle at each, with their backs towards the wall, the interior walls.
Oh, that's my favorite. Okay. The Orbitron. One of my favorite rides as a kid was the Orbitron. And that's the round room that you stand in. Preferably with your back against the wall, because the thing will start to spin. And then the floor drops from underneath you, so you're stuck to the wall. And the thing's spinning, and it's spinning like this, and then it starts to tilt and do the thing and go in the air. And there's probably 12 people inside the thing. And all you do, all you do is play tricks. This was when people had flip phones. And I remember putting their flip phones on the wall next to them because they thought that was fun. And I just remember not being able to move. Somehow someone ended up upside down. I don't know how they did that. They ended up stuck to the wall upside down. So I'm thinking, how are they going to get... Okay, when the gravity comes back on, what are they going to do? Fall on their head? So I was curious how that was going to work out.
A small alarm begins to beep, 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 beep. Those of you that were not yet awake, there's a jarring sensation that pulses through the jump pod as you that shakes every one of you. inside.
Christmas. I'm sitting serene, my eye closed, breathing slowly. I guess the drop's gonna be the worst part, guys.
I wake up with a start. Grab the harness with my hands. Look, panic to either side. You haven't been in a drop before, have you, kid?
No, it's my first time. I look around.
Wish I could say it was my first.
To Remus's left, an old younger man. A younger man looks over, and he's also shaking. He says, "Oh, how you guys doing?
Oh. Relax, son. You get used to it."
That's what them officers always say right before we land, and then we all die.
Andrus shakes the fog out of his head, looks around at his surroundings, and realizes he's shaking around like crazy. What in tarnations? Where they dropped us now? Holy shit.
An older man looks at Theodorian calmly as he as his chair shaking, just watching him. As a voice comes over a speaker inside of the drop pod. "We at the Galactic Empire are saddened to have failed at integrating you into our diverse and welcoming culture. Know that we strive to do better with our citizens in the years to come."
Bastards.
Yeah.
Shove your propaganda up where the sun don't shine, he yells.
Just then, a sensation of free fall enters the pod, and the turbulence gets even stronger.
As I was serene, now I start to tense up, and now I get the shake, sitting in my seat.
My head back, eyes closed, fiercely shut. I start muttering inaudibly to myself.
A woman's voice comes over the intercom. "We hope that you find enrichment in your new life. Be advised that transit pod to your new home has been carefully inspected and successfully met all UECC standards. Brought to you by Unicorp."
Complete bullshit.
Could happen to us and probably to die.
I would want to reach for her neck and strangle her from where I'm sitting in this pod.
Yeah, that doesn't inspire confidence, I gotta say.
I keep praying, eyes shut.
So I wonder if the players each had a secret about themselves that only they know. Or if one of them was a mole, or if one of them was the Manchurian candidate, or one of them was, you know, I don't know. I always throw in a wrench somewhere.
The old man speaks up. He's looking at you, Theodore. "I know you."
"Yeah?"
"Yes, you were a journalist."
"It was a long time ago. I give it up."
His pot is shaking.
"There was a time, yes."
And just looks to the left and to the right, seeing who's next to him. "You! Where are you from?" He shakes at his chair.
Okay, so this is Doc Flamingo. I'm going to guess that he's still playing as a 1D player. This is a 4D game, and they got a 1D player in the group. 1D players tend to, they just want to be told a story, and they want to, they just want to be an audience. They want to be an audience member at the table. So, I don't know. I've always said vet your players. Vet your players. See if they can role play or not. I'm not sure why he's in the game if he's not role playing. I don't know. I have my suspicions why he's in the game, but I say maybe I'll be nice and say he needs practicing and vetting before he comes back in these game sessions. Because this is 4D. This is a 4D game session. Is he going to sit here and say nothing? Unless his character is mute. That could be.
You don't speak much, do you?
What are you talking to me for, man? We're all going to die.
We're not going to die
right now.
We're not going to die. No, we're not. We're going to.
Mr. Max is already wondering what's going on here. It could be part of the act. Maybe the player doesn't want to talk because his character doesn't have a mouth or something.
Get out of this alive.
I'm having a hard time.
Well, we're eventually going to die. Here's as good a place as any.
Hi, I'm Ryan Vega of the Gloriana Strikers. Ryan Vega. Before a big game, I do two things. I call my mama, and I take a drink of an ice-cold Blue Spark.
Oh, we didn't...
With 20 microunits of carbine, I know I'll have the energy to take it to those Endeavor Pulsars at tonight's game.
What kind of bullshit is this?
What do we have to hear? Like, we're being sent where none of that is going to be available to us. Why do we have to listen to advertisement again?
They're just taunting us. They're taunting us now.
Hold on.
Whoever authorized that ad buy should wind up here, frankly.
Where are we going?
Guys.
Cat attack.
This is a new life you're being offered.
I didn't choose this.
See it as a gift.
I'd rather not.
You have been chosen.
At that moment, a explosion from beneath the transit pod as there's a massive force or massive, you feel a massive force slowing your fall and a stream of what sounds like jet engines. Your scent is, you can tell your scent is beginning to slow down.
Your spine goes into your ass. I've been on this ride. It's called
more gentle than I expected.
It's called Mission to the Moon. No, it's called.
Yeah.
Disneyland had two rides. It was a flight to the Moon and Mission to Mars. And both of them had this. They were the same exact ride.
We have a comedian among us.
My neck muscles are strained as I'm fighting against the G's as we're getting hit by these retro rockets slowing the pod. Oh, this is the worst part.
It's almost over.
The old man looks over at you, or at Andrus, and says, I know you too. You're famous, aren't you?
Most that know me are either dead or still fighting.
Dead, I'd say.
Perhaps, but there may be some hope at the end of this, he says.
I look at Andrus. What are you hoping for?
Get out of this alive. And if you guys are willing to come, and survive together. Whatever may be happening, we'll get out of this, I assure you.
Our only chance will be to stick together. A wise thought.
Okay. Is Doc even in the scene? Is he in the shot? Is he in the frame? Is he on the pod? Because he acts like he's just an audience at the table who's just, you know, this is the peanut gallery guy back here. Everyone's kind of serious about their character except for him. I don't know. I don't understand this. Why is he in the game?
I'm not running.
The younger man looks at you, Andrews, and says, "No one escapes hell. No one's ever escaped hell. Are you crazy?"
So the planet's name is Hell.
Wait, that's kind of cool. Hell?
That's where we're going. Didn't they tell you, Remus? Or didn't they tell you?
So are we already dead?
No, hell. You ever heard of hell before?
Well, of course.
Some kind of crazy prison world.
My grandmama used to tell me about it. It's red and hot. It smells like sulfur, they said.
I think it's going to be green.
You hear tink, 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 tink. And your descent begins to speed up again. And then one more. And then there's another. When the descent stops again suddenly. And it's not. You barely even feel that you're descending at this point.
Did we hit the ground?
Not yet. Not yet.
Oh, fucking wrong.
The old man points up at a set of numbers decreasing. He says, "I think that's our altitude."
And it's going to be there soon.
It looks like another 1,000 feet.
I'm bracing myself in my seat.
Andrus looks around, is searching around, seeing if there's any panels around, little cubby holes, that sort of thing. Taking assess of everything around him.
It's a lot of flat metal panels on the floor. There is one bag under everyone's chair.
Ah!
A small bag. And
that's cool.
Number of metal rafters across the ceiling. Small control panel over at the door. The exit.
Looks like we all have a kit of some form underneath our seats. We should be prepared to get our stuff together when we land. Hopefully it's not too rough. Hopefully it's on land. Gentlemen.
If I may make a suggestion, we should probably disassemble any part of this craft that we can. We're unlikely to find metal where we're going. We might be.
What is he doing? I would be bracing for impact. I wouldn't be. I don't understand.
Be able to use parts as weapons, as shields, all manner of useful items.
Hold on, are you an engineer? You know mechanics, that sort of thing?
A little bit. I was in the military. I did some construction.
Good, good, good. It'd be useful. Hey, any of you scientist types?
I got some scientific studies.
Good, good, young man, good.
Well, I'll be happy to take that bag off your hands then. Young man,
that bag.
You touch that bag, I'll lay you out. I'll lay you out. Yeah, you try it.
Hey, you seem like a strong guy. You and me. I could be your friend.
You seem about as smart as I am. I don't need someone as dumb as that. I wish we just land.
The counter is ticking down. 300 feet now.
Andrus braces.
Shaking has stopped. And
I notice Phil, your camera freezes every time you change the picture. So there's a better way of doing this picture stuff without your camera freezing, because you have to upload it to whatever StreamYard. StreamYard has to cache it to its camera coder, whatever, you know. It's adding this image to your camera. So hopefully it doesn't keep doing that during the game, because it should remember the one you used.
The old man says, any moment now, we hit the bottom.
I look at Remus. So you've been in the drop before?
Yeah, I has a long time ago. What happened? It was bad. It was bad. It was stupid. Officers said it would be no problem. Half the pod died. I got hurt bad. Then they just washed me out. Didn't get a pension or nothing.
I regret I asked.
Oh, shit. Young man. Shuts his eyes.
I look over at the young man. Size him up. Yeah, I could take him.
He just has his eyes shut. Muttering, mouthing some words to himself. 150, 100, 75, crash. The pod begins to, clearly is flipping end over end.
Just like this.
And it ends up on its side. You can feel it's like there's like a swinging motion going on.
We appear to be hung up, gentlemen. This could be a problem.
Or worse.
Unbuckling the everything, trying to force this metal cage off me that the guards straps, put down.
The straps provide too much of resistance against you. Up until a second later, and then the safety harness just lifts up. The young man who was at the top of the pod falls down and lands busting his head on the bottom of the pod, on the what is now the bottom of the pod.
I lowered myself down there and take a look at him. I have some medical training.
Okay. Yeah, Doc Flamingo, he's not saying where he's at and what he's doing. He's just a floating head that talks.
Stand up from my seat, look at the body of the young man on the floor. Grab my bag underneath, over my shoulder.
Grab the Andrus. Get your medical.
Where to now, boss?
Let's gather our belongings. Grab everything you can. It grabs his bag underneath. Come on, let's get ourselves out of here.
I grab my bag. I dislodge myself from the seat. I look around. I told the guy, "Welcome home, guys."
I try to climb up to where the bag is on the ceiling, where the guy that fell out busted his head. I think I might take that bag. He might need it later. And if he doesn't make it, then we'll need it.
The boy that fell has a large gash across his forehead, and he seems dazed.
Okay. I tear his sleeve off.
From a concussion.
And create a bandage with it. And sit him up.
That's fast travel right there. Tear off his sleeve and make a bandage of it that fast, instantly? I don't think so.
Right. You just relax, son. We're going to get you out of here as soon as we find out what's going on. We appear to be swinging from something, gentlemen. That's not a move around too much in the cabin until we've sussed out what our situation is. And I start climbing up towards the door to release it, to see where we are.
Here. Andrus gives William a hand, pushing him up. Here. And gives him a push up.
Mr. Max, once again, Mr. Max is like being, he's exercising extreme patience.
You hear a tink, 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 and the pod changes orientation again.
Yeah. At
the top.
That's how these things work. The pod changes orientation. This isn't the Poseidon Adventure. If I was in this game, my character would be still in his seat, holding on to the strap, because he knows it's the ride isn't over yet.
Of the what was the top of the pod is now the bottom, as it begins to swing a much wider arc.
Nobody move around too much. Maybe in a bad spot.
I quickly grab like on the harness that has been open, holding myself to it.
Give me a dexterity check, William. Yes. And Remus.
Six.
Six plus one, seven.
Plus. Seven.
Success. The dangerous scaffolding at that.
I gotta get a drink. Hey, one problem I have is that the reason this is a slow start because the four of the players are counting on the fifth player to say or do something. And since he doesn't say anything, and they're being polite, I guess, the game stops. The game stops while the player doesn't do anything. And the rest of the players are sitting there waiting for him to do his thing, which is roleplay. And he hasn't roleplayed yet. He's just giving very generic answers to things. So far, this guy here, Doc Flamingo, he's playing an NPC. He's doing less. Okay, The referee has two NPCs that he's role-playing. He's also got voices on the radio that he's doing. And Doc Flamingo here is supposed to be one of the main characters, and he's role-playing like he's just an NPC.
Marked the top of the ship. Not affecting you in any way, but the boy is, he slips down and is now underneath some of that scaffolding and bent in a kind of an awkward way. He's like, groans. Clearly his leg's broken as well.
Let's get out of here, guys.
Yes, get out.
Push through the door.
I reach underneath the young man's seat, grab his bag, sling it over my shoulder, holding on to the harness.
Good idea.
Look over. Where's the exit? It should be just over there. They just stamp these things out.
There were controls near the exit, so look for the controls. They're on the wall somewhere.
Okay, I push the door open. I prop myself out. Enough where I still feel secure, and I look around to see what our situation is.
What? He just pushes the door open? He doesn't even say where he is. He doesn't even say where he is. He's going to be that NPC that just happens to be at every entrance, every exit.
Yes.
Door easily opened with the control panel next to it. Opens up. The door opens upward though, and it's just there's just the lip of the pod between you and the outside. You're approximately 25 feet up in the air, dangling from the pod is 25 feet up in the air, dangling from a large tree. Below the pod is a number of limbs and a very rapidly moving river.
All right,
outside in the world of hell is the bright purple skies. Foliage outside is a mixture of greens and blues. Number of wildflowers of all sorts of colors. Sounds that are alien to spacefarers ring out, a constant buzzing of bzzz that a planet dweller would recognize as the sound of insects.
This is hell.
A few birds fly past the opening of the pod.
I slowly make my way toward the opening, stick my head out. Well, look like we're in a bit of a pickle. I dig my bag.
It's probably safest if we climb up and then down the tree. We don't want to fall in that river.
Andrus helps Theodore brace himself along on the wall as he's... I go ahead and latch the bag across my shoulder as well.
What if we all go back into our seat, bring back the harness down? One of us could go and try to dislodge the pod. The pod would probably like protect us if we fall.
I don't know about you. I don't like the idea of going down a river in this pod. It's a good play to drown.
Well, the pod is going to float. We're going to end up in a nice beach somewhere.
Why would it float? It's a big metal thing. I start. I make my way down to the.
Never seen a ship before.
Ship? No, I don't go on. I was a ground pounder, man. We don't go on the. I walk down to where the guy is moaning, twisted in the scaffolds. I bend down close to him when I get to him.
The old man is crouching, already next to that younger man, trying to with his. Clearly weakly trying to pull the boy out from his tangled situation.
I turn to the old man. You better go with the others. I'll take care of this guy. I got it.
I can help.
I whisper to him so he can only hear. There's only one help that's going to help him now, and that's a quick release. Are you prepared to do that? You got to end a wounded animal. There's no one helping us. We got to help ourselves. I got this. Is he kin to you? Is this your son?
He looks at you as the color drains from his face and stands up quietly. Begins to climb his way up to the exit of the pod.
I watch him go.
I'm going to climb up to the top of the pod and see how easily I think it would be to climb and or dislodge the pod.
This guy just climbed down the tree. Forget the pod. Just climb down the tree. I think we should set up a camp on top of the pod. It's our only hope for rescue. I mean, what? This game session is not about the pod, right? It's about a planet called Hell.
From the tree we're hanging in.
You can make athletics dexterity check.
Okay, my athletics, I'm pretty sure. I have athletic zero.
I mean, he's a doctor. Now he's some sort of a camp counselor. Next, he'll be a survivalist of some sort.
Dexterity plus one. 4, 5 plus whatever I get for the athletics.
Zero.
Okay, so what's the roll for? To see if he gets to the top of the pod or something? Maybe he wasn't a doctor. What was he? I've forgotten. He was like a construction guy or something? It seems like every time it's Doc's turn, he's a different character who's, I got this.
So the pod is gotten slippery from some sort of alien goop.
I would say the pod, there's nothing to grip on. Ever try to climb on the outside of a command module? It's kind of smooth. It's meant to re-enter Earth orbit. There's not much really to grab onto if you try climbing on the outside of the thing.
Off these broken branches and leaves and plants, causing you to slip.
Ouch.
Okay.
I attempt to grab hold of the pod on my way down.
Okay, so I don't know if they're narrating their successes or their failures or what, but somebody should be dead. Someone should be dying right now. Just saying. This doesn't turn into some Girl Scout camp thing. Campfire girls making marshmallows. This is Hell Planet. You know, have a flying dinosaur thing swoop. You know, the pod is covered in egg yolk. The thing crashed into some giant bird nest. And, you know, the mom has come back and sees that there's this pod smashed into a bunch of eggs. And the bird proceeds to, it's a giant bird. So, it uses the beak, pick the guy up by the head, flies off with the guy. That's it.
Andrus helps Theodore up towards the exit. Come on.
Wait.
Okay, in Planet of the Apes, I hate doing this, but in Planet of the Apes, 1968, how long were they in the pot? How long were they in there? They were in a lake. They were in a lake sinking. They all got out of the lake. How long was that whole scene? That whole scene in the movie. How long was it? It's like the pod is not your safe house. It's not a place where you just camp for the night. You're supposed to be role-playing that you're on Hell Planet, right? You got this one player who's playing an NPC. That's the problem with this game so far.
Let me check what is in those bags that they gave us. Maybe it's something useful. And I start like ruffling to my bag.
So, William, go ahead and give me a strength check. Inside the bag is...
5, 6, 7.
Inside the bag is a canteen full of water. And a wrapped up... it's like a package that looks... it's military issue food cube. It's good for 1 month nutrition.
I'm guessing Phil was making this up on the fly, all this stuff. Maybe there weren't bags, but now there's bags.
Well, they didn't give us any luxury for sure.
I bend down over the injured young man. Now just him and I. Look, kid. You're hurt bad. It's not good.
It's fine. It's fine.
No. It's not fine. What's your name?
My name is Isaac.
Isaac
Pulaski.
As I look him up and down. Isaac, tell me your story. And I wait for him to recount a little bit as he starts telling his story.
That was a space.
Crispy has to make up for the role play that hasn't been done. It makes sense. If we're going to be stuck in this pod, might as well make something of it.
Pirate.
Yeah.
And I got caught at a border check with some contraband.
I open up the bag, look through, looking for cigarettes. Nothing. All right.
When's the part where Crispy twists his neck? Helps the metal that's poking through the guy's neck, just helps the metal cut his head off, just a little.
Anyways,
what kind of contraband?
I'm left behind a wife.
What's her name?
Kid. Angie.
Well, I'm sure Angie will be just fine, I say. Tell me about your kid, and then as he starts to talk, I put my hands around his head and snap his neck.
Yay! Yay!
Hop.
Then I close his eyes. Just leave him there.
Good job.
What's your William. Assessment of William? What's your assessment out there?
One less character. You want to speed this up, right? You want to speed up this whole thing. I would think this would be a chase scene, right? The longer you stay in the pod, the more dangerous that pod's going to get. You know, they didn't say there were earthquakes on this planet as the pod shakes its way loose from the tree, starts rolling down a hill into the river. You want these guys to... They're playing, these guys are playing these cool looking dudes, right? These cool looking dudes, man of action types. No, this is not the time to be sitting around chit chatting. No. Jump out the door, jump out the hatch as the pod's falling down the hill. Something. You grab your packs and you run out. Grab your pack. Just jump out. Leap. What are you going to... Is the river going to kill you? Use the river to break your fall. You know, how deep is the river? The river was only a foot deep. Well, now, O'Shaughnessy's character jumped and said he totally dives into the water and swims across to the other side of the river. Barely. So now it's... Everyone knows it's a deep river.
Anyway. William, you've taken 2 points of damage.
Alrighty. So, but I am hanging on.
Sacrifice your butt.
Okay, so I secured myself back on top of the thing, and I try to get a lay of the land. How?
What? What is with the lay of the land thing? Ay, ay, ay. Just say it looks like a Brazilian canopy. End of story. That's the lay of the land. And it goes forever. And there's all kinds of noises. The sun's going down. The night creatures are coming out. They eat people. That's the lay of the land. What more do you want to know? Hey, let's everyone just sit around, make a campfire, sing some songs. No, that's not what this game's supposed to be.
What our situation is.
At the top of the, above the pod, you can see that what is keeping you in the tree. What's keeping the pod in the tree is a group of three parachutes tied with some cord to the pod. There's a number of trees around the tree that the pod is tied up in is another 50 feet taller than where you are. Difficult to say.
In the canopy. I assess the possibility of jumping towards the tree and grabbing lower limbs, if I think that would be feasible.
Aye. I think I'll build a car if I find enough scrap metal nearby, if that's feasible to do.
I think to myself, okay, what are we hung up on? Are we just hanging, dangling?
We're hanging from a tree. It looks to be a very, very rough climb. The ropes are wet. I do not advise trying that. We can either try to cut ourselves.
Just say the parachutes are tangled in the tree. We're dangling from the tree, hanging by the parachutes. Climb down the tree. What's the worst that could happen? The branches will break your fall on the way down?
Down, in which case someone would have to stay out here and be in a very bad way. But I think we can probably jump to the tree and grab some lower branches. We might take a bit of a spill, but I think we'll be all right. It's about 25 feet down.
Could we use the rope from the parachute?
Well, we could probably cut a couple ropes from down here, but they'd still be attached up top. Again, we'd have to climb.
Can you find some? Well, do we have?
If this was a movie, is this part exciting? Talking about ropes holding the pod in the air. Unless you're making a Swiss Family Treehouse adventure, Man, I can tell Phil's like, oh my God, they should be like doing things. Not playing capture the flag at the beginning of the game. They should be leaving the bird's nest.
Do you have anything to cut with? Is there any rope that are not taut, that are like loose?
I checked some of the ropes, check the condition.
I don't know. I was teasing with Phil the other day. Is this game going to be Predator? And I named off some other movies. You know, most dangerous. There's like five versions of Most Dangerous Game, which I didn't know. I thought, there's maybe two made, one in the 30s, one in the 50s. No, there's like one made every 5 years. Half of them are on TV movies. Most Dangerous Game. You know, what was another one recently, like in the last 30 years? What was it? Jurassic Park. Same situation. The Land That Time Forgot. You know, something like that. But this is hell. He kept telling me, no, this is wild hell. So, okay. I thought maybe a flame zombie would be in this. He would, I have a feeling his, whatever character he had, I have a feeling his character would just be doing the things. Now, Crispy, I've seen him before. I've seen Crispy do things with his character where he makes the scene end and then a new scene begin. I've seen him do that. So I hope he does that here. Because you don't want to spend more than 5 minutes inside of a space pod.
I leave Isaac's corpse, walk up to the old man by Andrus and Teddy.
The old man looks at you and nods. At the top of the pod, that very precarious climb covered in some unknown jungle slime is difficult to traverse. But there are a couple of ropes that there is some slack in.
We got a couple of
visible from the entrance of the pod.
I try to assess whether I could pull any one of the chutes, three chutes down, so we have access to both ends of the rope. I look at one, which I think is the least tongue tangled up, and I start.
Just say what you're doing. Just say what you're doing. Say where you're at, and then say what you're doing. That's all. Everyone else is doing that.
Yanking on that, see if I can get it loose.
Isaac, the old man looks out from the door. Says, "You'll have to climb around the pod to get to those ropes, young man."
No, Isaac's dead. Did he say Isaac? Isaac's dead. Maybe he got mixed up. Got two NPCs and we got four player characters. Too much. Too much for a pod.
I steady the old man, making sure that he's stable, not going to fall out.
Well, one of the NPCs is dead now, but still, it's one extra body.
Thank you. That's your.
Yeah, I'll reach out toward the door, and I'll try to grab one of those ropes.
Okay. Andrus, what do I call you? Andrus, is that your name?
Yes, you can call me Andrus.
Okay, what do you do now? Like, what are we doing? We can't stay here, right?
No, we're going to get ourselves down.
See, Crispy's already trying to end this scene and start a new one. Yay. You're playing Poseidon Adventure and you're just going to stay in the ballroom the whole movie? No, you're going to be on the move. You're going to be constantly on the move.
Yeah, we're just trying to figure out how to get.
We got to
grab one of the ropes here. 25 feet, apparently.
That's it?
Yeah, no telling what you're going to land on if you fall, though. That's the problem.
Let's see how that would work. I turn back to Isaac's corpse.
You hear another croaking or groaning.
Yeah, throw Isaac down there. See what happens.
Of whatever fastener is attaching the rope to the pod, and then it pops. And the pod once again changes its axis and swings again wildly. With the Adorn.
It's worth a check. I brace steadily, hanging on to Remus as well, and the old man.
I'm holding tight to that rope that I got. Yeah. See, guys?
I grab the girders near Isaac's body.
I wrap my arms. Yeah, I'm bettering
up something there.
Are we closer? Are we closer to the ground? He shouts.
Well, that depends on what you mean by closer. We are closer to falling to our demise.
It's those only 25 feet. Good. We used to jump into rivers all the time, 25 feet, Remus says. I don't know.
Yeah, just jump in the river. 25 feet, that's nothing.
No. Hey, sorry about this, Isaac. I pick up Isaac from the ground, and I drag him over to the door. And once at the door, I flip him out the door to see how he falls. And then I watch him hit just to try to gauge how big of a splash he makes on the...
Thank you, Crispy. Thank you.
The river below.
Poor young man. Compound fracture. Third degree. Lacerations to the skull. He wouldn't have been any use.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you got it, boss. You got it.
The young man flops down to the river and splashes in it. Doesn't go too deep. Just kind of floats along for a little bit.
Well,
gets stuck on a couple rocks.
Well, he doesn't seem to have hit any rocks. Remus climbs out the door. And with two bags in hand, drops to the river below.
Yay.
All right. Make an endurance check.
Man's got a pair of cojones on him.
A six. Seven. Sorry, seven.
Okay.
So I hit the water.
You doing?
I tried to hoist myself on the rope that I grabbed. And pull myself up, trying to get out of the capsule. I don't want to be stuck in there if it falls. Athletics?
I don't know what they're rolling for.
I want to use your other check. I was using the other checks.
These guys are getting banged up. I can tell.
So yeah, I'm hoisting myself out of the capsule toward where the chute is attached to the tree. He's standing on the tree.
Maybe if we pull on this together, we can get one of these to come down free and have some rope to work with. And it would not be a bad thing to have rope in this place.
Clear view of the last connection between the pod and the chute. Maybe moments before it pops as well, sending the pod to the river.
Well, it looks like our situation has made up our minds up for us, gentlemen. I suggest we get out of here very quickly.
Andrew.
I don't know. The dialogue coming from Doc Flamingo sounds like Captain Obvious stuff to me.
Address base, braces, eye brace for my impact. It falls.
Guys, you have to make a choice. Either, like, you fall with the pod, you fall without the pod, or you try to get out.
At the bottom, where Remus lands, the river is a little shallower than you than would be safe to jump into. You take 3 points of damage.
I kick off the bottom surface, grab my two bags, and look to the nearest shore and start swimming as quick as I can to that shore.
Pod swinging above you precariously.
Yeah, I look up nervously at that pod, swimming as fast as I can towards the shore.
Andrus.
One dead Isaac floats next to you.
I help the old man over to the one of the seas. Grab.
Well, that was a good touch. Isaac's body floats by you. Revenge!
Hold, we'll carry this out on to the ground, and I go for one of the seats as well. Ourselves back in.
I'm going to climb back inside. I say we just ride this down, gentlemen. It looks shallow water. If we strap ourselves in, we should be all right. Start strapping.
Okay, I can't watch anymore. The NPC here, he doesn't... I don't know. His character just doesn't sound believable. Anyway, well, that was interesting. I tried to watch it, Phil. You asked me if I watched it. I said I would. I tried to.